Hello everybody and welcome to video number 31 of the online version of the Fusion Research Lecture. We are in chapter 6, Turbulent Transport, and you might remember that in the last video we started to talk about turbulence in neutral fluids and introduced the Navier-Stokes equation. In this video we will look at the dimensionless form of the Navier-Stokes equation, because this can be very helpful for our purposes. So we will look at the dimensionless form of the Navier-Stokes equation. And to do that, we will first start with a simple sketch, make a drawing. We have some obstacle. Maybe we introduce another obstacle. So these two obstacles here. And this one as well. So this is just an obstacle. And the size of the obstacle is corresponds to a characteristic size in the system, capital L. Then we have the resulting streamline, so we have a flow streaming around the obstacles. That might look, for example, if it's some kind of water, so the streamlines might look like this, then this, and here in between them it's more or less straight. This one then goes more like this, and this one more like this, for example. Then we have also a typical velocity, which I use green. I'm not sure if you can see this. So this kind of thick green line here. This should correspond, this is a capital U, corresponding to a typical characteristic velocity of the system. So we have L being a characteristic size of the system, capital U being a characteristic velocity of the fluid. From these two quantities we can of course also define capital T, a characteristic time, using the characteristic length, capital L, divided by capital U, which then corresponds to a characteristic time. Now, introducing the dimensionless units then, the following dimensionless units. Dimensionless units, T prime, being T divided by capital T, then U prime being U divided by capital L over capital T, and capital L prime being R over L. And using these dimensionless units, we can then get the dimensionless form of the Navier-Stokes equation, which reads the derivative of with respect to T of the characteristic of the dimensionless velocity minus the gradient of the pressure plus 1 over R E. I will introduce that quantity in a minute, Laplacian, into the of the characteristic velocity. In principle also for the gradient and for the Laplacian we have to introduce this prime, so that we're also here in the normalized coordinate system. So let's highlight that. We have here, as I said, a introduced a dimensionless, an additional dimensionless units, and that unit, and that is RE. This is the Reynolds number. You might have heard of that. This is the Reynolds number, RE, which is equal as the coefficient of the mass of the fluid density, sorry, of the, divided by eta, the viscosity, the characteristic velocity and length, or being the same as the characteristic velocity times the length over mu, where mu is the so-called kinematic viscosity, the kinematic viscosity. And RE is the Reynolds number, an important number, an important quantity in the hydrodynamic or in turbulence in general. Because the Reynolds number tells us, something about the state the fluid is in. So for a fixed geometry, the Reynolds number basically determines the state of the fluid. So for a fixed geometry, the Reynolds number RE determines the state of the fluid. What do I mean by that? Let's have a look at the three examples that are included here. First of all, on the left-hand side, we have basically the same example as in the drawing on the previous slide. We have three obstacles, one, two, three, and around the obstacles there is a flow, and it is a laminar flow. So you can see we have nice streamlines, and we have a low Reynolds number for this case. If you see the long arrow on the bottom here, this means that the Reynolds number increases the further we go to the right. Then on the middle plot, we have obviously a slightly increased Reynolds number, and we see that we have some kind of vortices here. You see there's one row of vortices after each obstacle. This is why these rows are called vortex streets. And then if we further increase the Reynolds number, we basically have a lot of vortices, a lot of eddies here, until we finally end up here with a state of fully developed turbulence. So let's write that down. When increasing the Reynolds number, so if we have again a similar drawing where the Reynolds number increases into this direction, then we start with a laminar state. Then from the laminar state, we go into a state where we have these vortex streets, and these are also called Karman vortex streets. And these are basically rows of vortices with opposite rotational directions. So these are such a Karman vortex street is a row of vortices with opposite rotational directions. Now, if we further increase the Reynolds number, we get first an irregular appearance of vortices. So we get this kind of irregular appearance of vortices until we finally get a state of fully developed turbulence. This is what we've seen in the previous, in the drawing. Now let's have a look at some actual experiment illustrated here. We have three different states. In the top left one, let's start with the top left one, where we see again an obstacle around which a fluid is flowing. And here the streamlines streamlines in the water have been made visible by aluminum powder in the water. And here we have a relatively low Reynolds number of 1.54, and you see these nice closed streamlines. If you go to the next picture, we have, you already see that, you might see that here are two vortices behind that obstacle. So the Reynolds number has been increased and it is here approximately 26. And then if we increase the Reynolds number further, you can see that in this area, we basically, in this region, we have fully developed turbulence. And here we have a Reynolds number on the order of 2000, which resides in such a state of fully developed turbulence. And you can interpret the Reynolds number as follows. So one interpretation, interpretation is that the Reynolds number basically is the quotient, the coefficient of the non-linearity over the dissipation, where non-linearity is the part which creates, which drives the turbulence, and dissipation the part which reduces it. And this is why when we have a low Reynolds number, we have a low non-linearity term, a small non-linearity term or large dissipation, we do not have a turbulence. If we have a large Reynolds number, the non-linearity driving force is large and we get a state of fully developed turbulence. And so here we see again two photographies, and these are flowing soap films. So these are flowing soap films, vertically flowing from the top to the bottom. So they are basically falling down. And you can see on the left photography, we have these nice streamlines. So these are where very well separated, right? There's a bit of a non-linearity driving term here. So the Reynolds number increases if you go further down. Here you can see these nice vortices, which we have for here, for example. But interesting thing happens if we increase the Reynolds number, as you can see on this photography here, because for a large Reynolds number, the behavior is quite different and you get a lot of enhanced mixing properties, right? There's a lot of exchange going on into the perpendicular direction. This is something which you can also see nicely here in this photography, where these are smoke lines. So smoke is injected into a system, and you can clearly see these kind of enhanced mixing properties due to increased cross transport. And increase perpendicular transport. So what we can see here is, so first of all, this is smoke, what we see here. Nice photographies, beautiful photographies of smoke taken from this book, which is cited here. So definitely worth a look. And we can see that turbulence leads to enhanced mixing properties. Or maybe more importantly to say, it leads to increased cross, well, by cross, I mean perpendicular, increased cross transport, as nicely illustrated by this photography. A way to study the turbulence, the Navier-Stokes equation, is by studying the Burgers equation, which is very similar to the 1D Navier-Stokes equation. And also a very famous equation, so the Burgers equation, which you might know from your mathematical physics lecture or also from your hydrodynamics lecture. So this equation is similar to the 1D Navier-Stokes equation. Assuming that the fluid density is 1, and that there is no pressure, then it reads the derivative with respect to t of a velocity plus the velocity times the spatial derivative of the velocity. equal to the to mu times the second spatial derivative of the velocity. This can be solved, for example, numerically, as you might have done it in your numerical plasma physics lecture. One could use finer differences for that. So these are shown here are numerical solutions for that. So what is done here, this was solved numerically. One could use finer differences and just evolve it in time, then using the condition that u, so velocity as a function of x, is equal to u naught times, sorry for writing it like this, sine times the wave number times x. Then the nice thing about numerics, as you know, you can simply switch off the separate terms in the equation by studying then the other terms, for example, on the left-hand picture. So here, what we have looked at here, or what we look at here, is by just having an equation which reads the time derivative of the velocity is equal to minus the spatial derivative of the velocity, such that only this term in the equation has been used now, and this one we have cancelled out and just omitted it and neglected it here. Then the solution shown here, oops, shows us two plots. The dashed line here is the initial, the starting point, t equals zero, and then the other line, the solid line, is the solution after a characteristic time step. And we can see that we just get a propagating wave by that. Yeah, so this is just a propagating perturbation. This is just a propagating perturbation, as you might have expected from that. Now, just looking at the time evolution of the equation of the spatial derivative of u being equal to mu, and then the second derivative of u, so only the part on the right-hand side here, just looking at this equation, at this part of the equation, we can then see that, again, in this drawing, the dashed line is the initial, the starting condition, t equals zero, and then after a characteristic time step, we have the solid line, and we see that the amplitude has been reduced. So this term corresponds to damping. So this is the viscosity which we have here, the viscosity, and this results in damping. And this is on the microscopic level, this is basically inner friction which we have here. Now if we finally look at the nonlinearity, so meaning the partial derivative of u being equal to minus u times the spatial derivative of u, so looking at this term here, then we see that the nonlinearity resulting results in steep gradients, so that the nonlinearity results in steep gradients. As you can see on the plot, so again, the dashed line is the initial value, the initial solution, the starting point, and then here you can see after the time has evolved, here you can see these kind of steep gradients which we have here. Yeah, so basically we have something like, if you could also say we have higher harmonics here, and this can lead then to eddies. And now these two parts, so the viscosity and the nonlinearity, these two are always in competition. So these two are always in competition. And one way to express that is, as we said, the Reynolds number. Yeah? So these are in competitions which either results in a state where we have some kind of turbulence going on, or if you have more laminar system. Okay, that's it for this video, where we looked into the dimensionless form of the Navier-Stokes equation and introduced the very important Reynolds number, which determines the state of a fluid. We have looked at a few examples, introduced the expression Kármán vortex street, looked at again a few more examples. Then here finally on this equation, looked at the Borges equation, which is similar to the 1D Navier-Stokes equation, in order to have a look at the role of the different terms in the equation. Okay, that's it for this video. See you in the next video.